What does a torch look like? You probably thought of something a bit like this. But what if I told you that a torch could also look like this? This is the electrical circuit inside the torch, and removing all the other bits helps us to see all of its electrical components and how they're connected. We can look at the circuits for all sorts of electrical devices, like a doorbell, a fan, and even a television screen. I need to sit down. That one's making me dizzy. Electrical circuits are made up of two things: components, which do different jobs, and wires, which connect all the components together in different ways. Let's look at some components first. Here's a cell, a switch, a bulb, a buzzer, and a motor. A cell is a source of power. It causes electricity to flow in a circuit, and this flowing is called electrical current. Different cells can lead to different amounts of current in a circuit, and we can even join two or more cells together to create a battery. A switch controls whether a circuit is open or closed. For a circuit to work, it needs to be closed, which means there's a complete path along which electrical current can flow all the way around without any gaps. When a switch is off, it makes a gap in the circuit, which allows us to turn other components off as well. When a switch is on, the circuit is complete, which allows us to turn other components on as well. A bulb uses electricity to emit light. They come in all different strengths, colours, and sizes, from an enormous bulb in a lighthouse to a tiny bulb on the front of an oven. A buzzer uses electricity to emit sound. And a motor uses electricity to make things move. Okay, so we've got a cell, a switch, a bulb, a buzzer, and a motor. On their own, these different components aren't very useful. To put them in a circuit, we need to join them together with wires. Let's take a cell and use a wire to connect its positive end to its negative end. This is the simplest possible complete circuit. Electricity flows out of the positive end of the cell, along the wires, and into the negative end of the cell. The cell will eventually lose power, but nothing useful happens. Do not try this yourself though, as it can be very dangerous. The cell and wires will get very hot, and may even catch on fire.
Oh, whoops!
Let's make this circuit more interesting and safe by adding a bulb. There we go. Now we can see that current flows out of the positive end of the cell, along the wires, and into the bulb, making it light up. The current then flows out of the bulb and into the negative end of the cell, making a complete circuit. As long as the cell has power, the bulb will continue to light up. But what if we wanted to have the ability to turn the bulb on or off? For that, we need a switch. So far, it doesn't look like anything has changed. Like before, current flows out of the positive end of the cell, along the wires and the switch. It then flows into the bulb, which lights up, out of the bulb, and into the negative end of the cell, making a complete circuit. But if we turn the switch off, the circuit is opened, and you can see that the electrical current can't flow anymore. Because the circuit is no longer complete, the current can't flow through the bulb, so it no longer lights up. It doesn't matter where we place the switch. If it's turned off, the circuit is still not complete, so the bulb doesn't work. This means the switch gives us the ability to turn the bulb on or off. You might actually recognise this circuit, because it's the same as the torch we saw earlier. If you switch the torch on, it lights up, and if you switch it off, the light goes out. So we've made a torch, but just by replacing the bulb in our circuit with a different component, we can make some simple versions of other electrical devices too. If we swap the bulb for a buzzer, we get a doorbell. And if we swap the buzzer for a motor, we get a fan. By connecting just a few components together with wires, we've been able to make some really useful devices. So we know that there are different components that do different jobs, like a cell, a switch, and a bulb. But there are also different ways of wiring up a circuit that make it behave differently. Let's look at our torch again. As we've seen, electrical current flows out of the cell, along the wires and the switch, into the bulb, and back into the cell. This is known as a series circuit. Current flows through every component one after another in a series of steps. Cell, switch, bulb, and back again. Series circuits are often the most straightforward types of circuits that use the least amount of wire. The problem with a series circuit, though, is that if one component breaks, the whole circuit stops working. For example, let's add another bulb to our circuit. The series of steps now goes cell, switch, bulb 1, bulb 2, and back again. But if bulb 1 breaks, then everything stops working. The series of steps has been interrupted, and even though bulb 2 isn't broken, it can't light up. To fix this, let's arrange the circuit a bit differently. This is known as a parallel circuit. We haven't added or removed any components, we've just changed the wiring slightly. Like before, current flows out of the cell, along the wires and the switch. But now, it splits and flows along two different branches of the circuit at the same time to light up the two bulbs together. It then meets up to flow back into the cell. This time, if one of the bulbs breaks, the current can still flow through the other bulb, so it keeps working. It doesn't matter if the circuit has 3, 5, or 10 bulbs. Even if some bulbs break, the rest will keep working. Did you know that the lights in buildings are wired in parallel circuits? That's why if one bulb goes out, the whole building doesn't suddenly go dark. The other useful thing about lights in a building is that they can be turned on and off separately too. Let's bring our series circuit back and say that bulb 1 is a light in the living room and bulb 2 is a light in the bedroom. If I wake up and turn the light on in the living room, my partner's going to be a bit annoyed because the light in the bedroom is also going to turn on. But just like how we can wire up two bulbs in a parallel circuit, we can also wire up two switches in parallel as well. This time, each bulb has its own switch. I can turn the living room light on without also turning the bedroom light on, and I can turn the bedroom light on without also turning the living room light on. Other electrical components can be wired in parallel circuits as well. This is a very simple circuit for a toy car. A motor and a buzzer are connected in parallel to a cell, and both the motor and the buzzer have their own switch. We can turn the motor on to make the wheels go forwards, turn the buzzer on to sound the horn, or both. If the horn's buzzer breaks, the car can still drive around, and if the wheel's motor breaks, the horn can still sound. Let's play a game. I'm going to show you a circuit, and I want you to follow the path that the electrical current could take and work out what components will turn on. Here's the first one. If you want, you can pause the video and do it all by yourself, or keep watching and I'll do it with you. Okay, so let's start by going out of the cell and into the bulb, then go out of the bulb and into the motor. Finally, we'll go back into the cell. It's a complete circuit. That means the bulb will light up and the motor will move. Here's the next one. Okay, so let's start by going out of the cell and through the switch. Then split and go along the two branches of our circuit. We'll follow the first branch and go through the bulb, and then follow the second branch and... oh. It looks like the buzzer is broken, so we can't go any further on that branch. We'll keep going along the rest of the circuit and arrive back at the cell. Only the first branch is a complete circuit, so the bulb will light up, but the second branch is incomplete, so the buzzer will remain silent. Here's the last one. Okay, so let's start by going out of the cell. Then split and go along the first two branches of our circuit, which both have a bulb each. Then meet up and continue along the wire, splitting again to go along the next two branches of our circuit, which both have a buzzer each. Then meet up and continue along the wire, splitting again to go along the final two branches of our circuit, which both have a motor each. Then meet up, continue along the wire, and... oh dear, the switch is turned off. this isn't a complete circuit. So for this circuit, nothing happens. That's a shame. Okay, so let's quickly remind ourselves. A cell is a source of power. A switch controls whether a circuit is open or closed. A bulb uses electricity to emit light. A buzzer uses electricity to emit sound. And a motor uses electricity to make things move. All of these components can be wired in series circuits or parallel circuits. You might have noticed earlier that something interesting happened when we added a second bulb into our series circuit. Both bulbs were dimmer. That's because when we add more components to a circuit, the circuit's current decreases. This means that the bulbs can't shine as bright. We can measure the current of a circuit with a special component called an ammeter. It's called an ammeter because we measure current in a unit called amperes, or amps for short. For example, the ammeter here is measuring the current as 1 amp. The ammeter here, though, is measuring the current as 0.5 amps. The current here is half as much as the current here, so the ammeter measures half the amount of amps. This ammeter, however, is measuring 2 amps. The current here is twice as much as the current here, so the ammeter measures twice the amount of amps. Let's look at one of our circuits from earlier and measure its current by connecting an ammeter to it. It doesn't matter where we put the ammeter, the current in a series circuit is the same everywhere. Let's connect it up here. If we look at the ammeter's display, we can see that the current is 1 amp. Now, like before, we'll add a second bulb. We know that the bulbs end up being dimmer than before, but now we can see why. The current has decreased from 1 amp to 0.5 amps. If I add a third bulb, all the bulbs will be even dimmer, and you can see that it's because the current has decreased further from 0.5 amps to 0.3 amps. We can actually bring the current back up again by adding another cell. There we go. Now we can see that the current in this circuit has increased to 0.6 amps. If we add a third cell, the current increases back to 1 amp. So adding cells to our circuit increases the electrical current, but adding other components to our circuit decreases the electrical current. That means that the more bulbs I add, the dimmer they'll be. The more buzzers I add, the quieter they'll be. And the more motors I add, the slower they'll be. Remember though, this series circuit is just one of the ways we can connect these components together. What happens if the cell and the two bulbs are connected in parallel? I'll take out the bulbs, rearrange the circuit, and connect bulb 1 back up, like that. Then I'll connect bulb 2 back up, but on a separate branch. Look at that! There's still only one cell and two bulbs, but this time bulb 1 didn't get any dimmer when I connected bulb 2. How does that work? Well, let's add some ammeters to measure the current in this circuit. If you remember, one cell and two bulbs connected in a series circuit gave a current of 0.5 amps, and it didn't matter where we placed the ammeter, the current was 0.5 amps everywhere in the circuit. Now though, in a parallel circuit, there's a current of 2 amps here by the cell, and a current of 1 amp by the bulbs. The current isn't the same everywhere in the circuit. We can think of this parallel circuit as being made up of two different series circuits, this one and this one. Both of them have one cell and one bulb. We've seen that the current in a series circuit with one cell and one bulb is 1 amp, so that's why the current flowing through each branch of this parallel circuit is 1 amp as well. However, when the two branches meet, the current combines, which is why the current here by the cell is 2 amps. The same thing would happen if we had three bulbs in our circuit. The ammeter on this third branch is also measuring the current as 1 amp, like the other two branches. But this time, the ammeter by the cell has increased to 3 amps. If we add more bulbs to our parallel circuit, each individual branch will have the same current of 1 amp, but the overall current will increase. So why does this happen? Well, imagine you're in a long queue at a supermarket checkout. Let's say that one customer moves through the checkout every minute. Because there's only one checkout open, the total number of customers being served is also 1 per minute. If another checkout opens, the queue splits in two. There's still only one customer moving through each checkout per minute, but now the total number of customers being served has doubled to 2 per minute. If a third checkout opens, there are a total of 3 customers being served per minute. If a fourth checkout opens, there are a total of 4 customers being served per minute, and so on. So you might be thinking, if we can increase the current of a parallel circuit by adding more components on separate branches, isn't that like getting energy for free? We could power every device in the world with just one cell. Never worry about your phone running out of charge. Say goodbye to expensive electricity bills. All of the world's energy problems will be solved. Unfortunately, it doesn't work like that. That increased current comes at a price. Although components connected to a cell in parallel will have more power than components connected in series, that power won't last as long, so the cell will run out quicker. It's always a balance between power and time. Adding more components in series will mean they'll be less powerful but last just as long. Adding more components in parallel will mean they'll be just as powerful but last for a shorter amount of time. Let's play another game. I'm going to show you a circuit with an ammeter already attached, and I want you to work out what the electrical current is at other points in the circuit. Here's the first one. This ammeter measures the current here as 3 amps. What will this ammeter and this ammeter measure the current as? If you want, you can pause the video and do it all by yourself, or keep watching and I'll do it with you. Okay, so this is a series circuit, because every component is connected one after the other with no branches. That means the electrical current will be the same everywhere. The first ammeter measures the current as 3 amps, so that means that the other two ammeters will measure 3 amps as well. Here's the next one. This ammeter measures the current here as 2 amps. What will these 3 ammeters measure the current as? Okay, so this is a parallel circuit, because it has components along 3 branches, which all have a motor each. These 3 branches are all the same, so that means the current will be the same too. The ammeter on the first branch measures the current as 2 amps, so that means the ammeters on the other 2 branches will measure 2 amps as well. What about the last ammeter by the cell? Well, we know that the current here gets split up into the 3 branches, so we just have to put them back together again by adding the values up. 2 plus 2 plus 2 equals 6, so this last ammeter will measure the current as 6 amps. Here's the last one. This ammeter measures the current here as 8 amps. What will these 3 ammeters measure the current as? Okay, so this is another parallel circuit, because it has components along 3 branches, which all have a buzzer each. However, the buzzer on the second branch is broken, so this ammeter won't measure any current flowing through it. What about the other 2 ammeters? The ammeter by the cell measures the current here as 8 amps, and because there are 2 working branches, those 8 amps will split in 2. 8 divided by 2 equals 4. So these 2 ammeters will both measure the current as 4 amps. So far, we've seen lots of different circuits that haven't been too complicated. But what if you needed to draw the electrical circuit for something like this bulb mirror? Drawing all of those bulbs will make the circuit look very confusing. Luckily, we don't usually draw circuits as they look in real life. Instead of drawing a bulb mirror like this, we can draw it as a diagram, like this. That's much clearer. We always draw the wires as straight lines to keep the diagram nice and neat, and each component has its own symbol as well. A cell is drawn as a long thin line next to a short thick line. A switch is 2 circles with a line in the middle, which can show the switch open or closed. A bulb is a circle with a cross through it. A buzzer is a semicircle on top of 2 vertical lines. A motor is a circle with a letter M in it. and an ammeter is a circle with a letter A in it. There are actually lots of other components that do really interesting things and have their own symbols too. A solar cell uses energy from the sun to power a circuit. A resistor limits the amount of current that can flow through a circuit. Some types of resistors could be used for a dimmer switch on a bulb, or a volume control on a buzzer. A microphone is like the opposite of a buzzer. Instead of using electricity to emit sound, it uses sound to emit electricity, which can be used to record sound. An antenna can use electricity to emit radio waves, which can be used to send sound over long distances, like in a mobile phone, or control circuits from a distance, like in a remote-controlled car. And a fuse is a safety device that will break a connection in a circuit if the current gets too high. Did you know that a lot of plugs in the UK have a fuse built in them? That means that if the current gets too high for some reason, like if the device it's powering breaks, the fuse will blow and the circuit will be broken, stopping the device from becoming dangerous. Okay, so let's quickly remind ourselves one more time. Electrical circuits are made up of different components, such as a cell, a switch, and a bulb, which are connected with wires in different ways, such as in series or in parallel. Current is a measure of the electricity flowing through the circuit and is measured in amps. In a series circuit, the current is the same everywhere, and in a parallel circuit, the overall current is shared among all the branches. If you want to keep practicing, download the worksheet in the video description. If you want to experiment by making your own circuits, check out this free circuit construction kit by FET Interactive Simulations in the video description. If you like this video, make sure to give it a thumbs up. Subscribe to learn more science, English, and maths with Will, and let me know what you want to learn next by commenting below or emailing info@learnwithwill.co.uk.